10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
Look Up, an Italian space agency's podcast. The characters and exploits of man's great adventure to conquer space. Rocco Anthony Petrone, the Tiger of Cape Canaveral.
I miss the earth so much, I miss my wife. It's lonely out in space. On such a timeless flight.
What an extraordinary man Rocco Anthony Petrone was. He served as the launch director of the Apollo 11 mission, which landed the first man on the moon. He was the one to give the go, whispering, "God bless you, we can make it." What strength, ingenuity, and passion he had. Over 6 foot tall and 220 pounds, the manager with nerves of steel was able to stop the countdown of an important mission to save the lives of a couple of herons that had placed their nest too close to the launch pad. Rocco Anthony Petrone showed great determination, an unwavering desire to reach for the sky, but also a commitment to monitor everything, verifying every minute detail, because he thought approximation was not the best of traits when dealing with formidable adventures that could change history. He was the one to see that the flight consoles of Apollo 11 were showing a very dangerous leak of liquid hydrogen in the second stage of the rocket, only 4 hours ahead of the launch. He took action and saved the mission and its astronauts. He was known as the Tiger of Cape Canaveral, storming for hours around the launch control center as a caged animal. The famous firing room 1, the central desk where hundreds of people recorded and followed every detail of the Apollo 11 mission. His rants had made history as reported in the docufilm Luna Italiana, Italian Moon, by Marco Spagnoli and in Renato Cantore's book Dalla Terra alla Luna. Two very touching tributes to such a talented individual that from nothing became the third most influential person at NASA. As Cantone put it, the son of farmers from Lucania who had sought their fortunes in America. He was born in Amsterdam, New York in 1926. He was not yet 6 months old when his father died in a terrible accident run over by a train. A life of sacrifice awaited him, from which he did not shirk. With an impressive physique and a brilliant mind, he worked to secure himself an education. At 17, he was admitted to the West Point Military Academy, where he joined the football team that won the national championship. And then, he fulfilled his American dream. Rocco Anthony Petrone became a leading expert on missiles and launch pads, finally earning his nickname of Space Tiger. When Rocco Petrone's parents arrived in the US just after World War I, it felt like they were landing on a very distant planet. They were migrants from Sasso di Castalda, a tiny village of 1,000 souls perched on the Lucanian Apennines. They were poor and lost, but determined to make it, just like their little boy, whom they called Rocco in honor of their village saint. Rocco grew up fatherless. As a teenager, he studied and worked at the same time to bring money home. He started out by selling ice on the streets of Amsterdam, and by the early 1940s, he was already a model student, a young working-class hero, and one of the most brilliant students who graduated from Wilbur Lynch High School. He was known for his tremendous memory and formidable calculating ability. For scholastic merits, he was able to attend the West Point Military Academy and later graduate from MIT, the Massachusetts Institute of Technology, one of the most illustrious universities in the world. He was a soldier, but at the same time a technician and a man of science. When he was only 30 years old, he was appointed Deputy Chief of Staff for Logistics at the Army General Staff at the Pentagon. He was in charge of the deployment on U.S. soil of the 12 major missile systems, basically the backbone of national defense. That was a key assignment, not simply a prestigious position, especially back then in 1956 when the world was in the midst of geopolitical tensions and the Cold War. There was also a time when the race for space supremacy was in full swing. The Russians were already leading, leaving the US behind, and the Americans knew it all too well. So they called in a German scientist to head the US space program. Werner von Braun, the man who had been in charge of Nazi Germany's solid fuel rocket research and development. After turning himself in and decided to work with the US Army, von Braun moved on to NASA as director of the Marshall Space Flight Center, as well as designer of the Saturn V launch vehicle, the heavy launch rocket that carried the Apollo missions to the moon between 1968 and 1972. Working alongside him was Petrone himself. At first, their relationship was far from idyllic. They were both reserved and quiet individuals. Petrone was highly cautious, almost suspicious of the German scientist's previous life experience. But then gradually their working relationship turned into a true friendship.
Mars ain't the kind of place to raise your kids. In fact, it's cold as hell. And there's no one there to raise them. If you did,
von Braun was given the task of designing the giant Saturn V rocket, 110 meters high and more than 10 meters wide, practically as imposing as the Asinelli Tower in Bologna. Petrone was asked to build the launch pads for the entire program on Merritt Island, just across from Cape Canaveral, on an equally immense area. The components of the Saturn V launch vehicle had to be stacked together inside a gargantuan building, the so-called vertical assembly building, as large as the Pentagon, in which to assemble piece by piece the mammoth flying creature, as Wire magazine noted in an article commenting on the new mobile launch concept. This was the embryonic beginning of Apollo 11. The Apollo program made a leap forward when in 1961 John Fitzgerald Kennedy became the 35th US president and Gagarin was launched into space. In his address to Rice University, JFK did not beat around the bush and said it loud and clear, "We choose to go to the moon." The president met Petrone twice, the second time 6 days before his brutal assassination in Dallas. Rocco was given a promise he had to honor, and he did it, to take American astronauts to the moon. At 9:32 a.m. on July the 16th, 1969, it was Rocco Petrone, the boy who had to grow up fast, who gave the go and sent Apollo 11 into orbit, carrying Neil Armstrong, Buzz Aldrin, and Michael Collins. We do not know whether his voice was shaking or his heart racing, but it was his call, and he said go, and after that, nothing was ever the same.
And I think it's gonna be a long, long time till touchdown brings me round again to find.
Rocco Petrone also said no, but it happened many years later. He left NASA in 1975, but his round no was said about the launch of the STS-51L mission of the Space Shuttle Challenger, scheduled to take place on January the 28th, 1986. He was against it, the reason being that he was afraid that the freezing temperatures of the night could damage the heat shield of the rocket's thermal protection system. His alarm was not heeded. The orbiter disappeared in an explosion 73 seconds after liftoff, claiming its 7-people crew and vehicle. The cause of explosion was determined to be the failure of the pressure seal in the aft fuel joint of the right solid rocket booster. cold weather was determined to be a contributing factor. Rocco had had a premonition. He retired and spent his last years in California studying American history, a subject he was passionate about. He died at the age of 80 on August the 24th, 2006. Teresa Petrone, one of his four children, shared some very moving memories of her father. When we were children, we didn't realize what an extraordinary job our dad had. In the small town where he lived, at Cape Canaveral, everyone was busy for the moon landing technicians, scientists, astronauts. We lived among their families. It was our everyday life. We were used to hear people talking about spacecraft and men in space. For us, that was certainly a great engineer, but because he put magic lights on our Christmas tree, carved pumpkins at Halloween, or painted Easter eggs. Rocco Anthony Petrone, a man as strong as the rocks of his Lucania homeland, his gaze set into the sky will never be forgotten. The Italian Space Agency has named its Matera Laser Ranging Observatory after him, and the Launch Control Center at NASA's Kennedy Space Center at Cape Canaveral, the world's most important space launch complex, was renamed after this pioneer in America's quest for space exploration.
And I think it's gonna be a long, long time. So touchdown brings me round again to find.
Thanks for listening to Look Up, an Italian Space Agency's podcast. The characters and exploits of man's great adventure to conquer space. Script, Daniela Amenta. Post-production, Paola Pagone. Editorial coordination, Giuseppina Fulcano and Manuela Puglietti.